What's up, y'all? It's me, Jaren Lim, your Indonesian mental health advocate. For the next few episodes, I'm going to talk about facts and myths about psychiatric medications, such as antidepressant. Kita bakal kupas tuntas semua fakta-fakta dan mitos tentang obat-obat psikiatris seperti antidepresan. Dan buat neurodialectikers yang orang Indo, jangan lupa kalau semua video-video gue itu tersedia dalam dua bahasa subtitlenya. Ada bahasa Inggris sama bahasa Indonesia. Jangan lupa dinyalain ya kalau butuh. Statement number one, medications have many side effects. Don't take meds. Just think positively, everything is just in your head. Sure, let's go with that logic. Say you got prescribed fluoxetine or Prozac, and then you went on Google looking for the side effects of fluoxetine, and you would find thousands of websites listing the side effects of fluoxetine, even the black box warning saying that antidepressant can increase the suicidal thought and behavior in children, in adolescent, in young adults with major depressive disorder. It would then freak the shit. You will then change your mind. You think to yourself, I would just think positively. I would exercise and eat well and I'll be fine. But it's tough. You ruminate for the whole day, which causes extreme distress. You can't function well during the day. You feel stressed and depressed. Most of the days, your parents or peers told you that you were just tripping. You didn't try enough. You were just being lazy. You got more stressed and depressed because of the invalidation. You then start to reconsider taking antidepressant, and the cycle keeps going on and on, and finally, you crash. I will present you with at least two arguments in this video, and leave this question open-ended for you all. First of all, let's be real. Let me just use a simple example from our daily life. Everything in our life has side effects, including vitamin, even the oxygen that we're breathing in right now. We don't need to talk about psychiatric medication on this first video. I'm just going to give an example from over-the-counter medication or even vitamin and even oxygen. That's what we call as the oxygen paradox. Simply stated, the oxygen paradox proposes that although oxygen is essential for aerobic beings, it is also inherently dangerous for the very same life form. Our body uses oxygen as an electron acceptor in our metabolic pathway. Without oxygen, we will definitely die. However, simply by breathing in the exact same oxygen molecule that we just inhaled just now would turn into ROS, or reactive oxygen species, like hydrogen peroxide or oxide ion. ROS is actually a natural byproduct of our metabolic pathway, but it can cause oxidative stress, such as DNA damage and ion leakage. This is also known as MFRTA. MFRTA is mitochondrial free radical theory of aging. This theory proposes that mitochondrial free radical produced as a byproduct of metabolism cause oxidative damage. In other words, the very same oxygen molecule we just breathe in right now is both useful and harmful to our body. How is it possible? I'm going to show you a study that my professor at UC Davis, Dr. Aldrin Gomes, co-authored. One of my favorite classes at UC Davis. One of his researches focuses on the molecular mechanism involved in the side effects of NSAID. NSAID is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, such as ibuprofen, naproxen, and meclofenamide sodium. This class of drug can cause an increase in ROS in our body, which can significantly decrease our life expectancy. In this study, they used the H9C2 cardiac cells and neonatal cells. They divided the cell samples into six groups. The first group is the control group, that is, the cells were untreated. The second group is cells treated with ROS. And in this experiment, they used hydrogen peroxide as the ROS. And the third group is the cells treated with NSAID. And in this experiment, they used meclofenamide sodium, or MS, as the NSAID. They saw that both cells treated with hydrogen peroxide and meclofenamide sodium had only 60% relative cell viability compared to control, but there is no significant differences in the relative cell viability between the cells treated with hydrogen peroxide and the methylphenidate sodium. For the last three groups, they added 200 micromolar of ascorbic acid, an antioxidant, or in the layperson term, vitamin C, that would scavenge the ROS to the cells, as in the setup number 1, 2, 3. Surprisingly, treatment using vitamin C causes all the cells to return to 100% relative cell viability. So there is no difference between the cells that were initially treated with ROS and methylphenidate sodium relative to the control. What does this mean? There are at least three conclusions that we can draw from this experiment. Firstly, NSAID, such as methylphenidate sodium, and ROS, such as hydrogen peroxide, can decrease cell viability significantly compared to control. And secondly, an antioxidant, such as vitamin C, could reverse the effect of ROS in our body by scavenging the ROS. And lastly, methylphenidate sodium, an NSAID, may decrease life expectancy by increasing ROS in our body. Does that mean that if we take vitamin C every day, or vitamin E, an antioxidant, we will have longer life expectancy? Or does that mean if we can eliminate all the ROS in our body, we would have longer life expectancy? Surprisingly, one of the most recent studies showed that regular high-dose vitamin C intake may reduce your lifespan by up to a quarter, which is counterintuitive to the previous study I just showed you. Say your life expectancy is 100 years old. By regularly taking high dose of vitamin C, it would reduce your life expectancy to 75 years old. How is this possible? Apparently, this topic is controversial. Older data supports the MFRTA, while new data tends to challenge the MFRTA, indicating that ROS can actually extend lifespan, at least in lower organisms such as worms and flies, and also in voles. Fun fact, we all have 3-4% of ROS homeostatically in our body. Going back to the oxygen paradox, that's actually the view that I hold. Some studies have actually shown the role of ROS in our body. For example, it is responsible for cell signaling and apoptosis, or programmed cell death. Think about it. If your cells keep on proliferating nonstop, no death, it would be very detrimental to our body. It would cause, theoretically, malignant tumor or even cancer. In other words, when you have too much ROS in our body, your life expectancy shortens significantly. Then you take vitamin C or vitamin E to decrease the ROS in your body to increase your life expectancy. However, when the ROS in your body is stable at 3-4%, you take vitamin C or vitamin E regularly, and then your ROS falls dramatically. You will also Let's go back to the original question. Medications have many side effects. Don't take meds. Just think positively. Everything is just in your head. Same exact logic. Should I then take ibuprofen or vitamin C? Listen, if you are sick, go ahead and take it. In fact, many recent studies have shown that high-dose vitamin C actually decreases the length of stay of COVID-19 patients. Then, how do you decide whether or not you should take meds? When you are deciding whether or not you should take meds, first thing first, make sure you're in your wise mind. And secondly, make sure that you include your healthcare professionals, such as your psychiatrist, your clinical psychologist, or therapist, when you're making a decision. One of the skills that I really like from DBT, or dialectical behavioral therapy, is pros and cons skill. When you're making a decision, make sure you ask yourself and draw this table. Ask yourself, what are the pros of taking meds? What are the cons of taking meds? What are the pros of not taking meds? What are the cons for not taking meds? And then you compare the outcomes and ask yourself, do I have more pros than cons, or do I have more cons than pros? And from there, make the decision. Wait, why do I need to include my healthcare providers, such as my psychiatrist or therapist, in making the decision whether or not I should take medication? This is my second argument. Psychiatrists is a medical doctor. They went to a four-year college to get an undergraduate degree, and then they went to medical schools for another 4 years, plus residency and fellowship until they can actually get the MD or DO and they can practice as a psychiatrist. It takes at least 10 years of education and training for them to get the psychiatrist degree. And our treatment philosophy is evidence-based treatment, meaning that our treatments are based on thousands and years of researches, not just based on your gut feeling. And psychiatrists don't just randomly prescribe you medications. Furthermore, when assessing your symptoms, we currently use DSM-5, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders, 5th edition. It is also evidence-based, meaning it comes from years and thousands of researches and statistics written by the American Psychiatric Association, not just a random person writing a guideline based on their personal experiences or intuition. After intricately assess you, psychiatrists will then make a working diagnosis. From there, they will do the pros and cons regarding what treatment is best for you. Do you need meds? They would do the lab work such as vitamin D, TSH, CBC, CMP to see how your thyroid, your kidney, or your liver function, or if you have any comorbidities, or if you have any differential diagnosis. For example, people with abnormal thyroid hormone can mimic depressive symptoms. And then, if you need meds, what meds are the best for your diagnosis that causes least side effects and do not contraindicate your current pre-existing illnesses? Do you also need a talk therapy? Do you need to see a clinical psychologist? You need to see a therapist, or maybe you need both medications and talk therapy. That's what healthcare professionals are for. Just like the flu, some people need just rest and they will eventually get better. However, some people might need meds, antibiotics. Some people might need ibuprofen and NSAID and vitamin C to get better. Fun fact, in 2018 to 2019 alone, CDC estimated that there were 35.5 million people got influenza. 490,600 people were actually hospitalized inpatient due to influenza. And you know what? 34,200 people died from influenza. Or some people might have chronic disease that requires them to take medications for their whole life, like diabetes, for example. If you are dying, are you going to say medications have many side effects, don't take meds? Are the pros more than the cons for taking meds in that case?
And the important part is just because there's a chemical name to a substance, it doesn't make it automatically bad or dangerous. And on the flip side, if something is claimed to be all natural, doesn't mean that it's all safe.
If you have watched my previous videos, you would now understand that mental disorders do not differ from physical disorders in the sense that they all have biological basis. So telling them to just suck it up, just to think positively, and everything is just in your head shows how stupid, ignorant, and fool you are. And similar to the oxygen paradox, there is also serotonin paradox. We touched a little bit about SERT, or serotonin transporter, in the previous video. If you haven't watched it, go ahead and watch it. In the late 1960s, evidences began to emerge suggesting that there's a significant role of serotonin in MDD, or major depressive disorder. For example, a postmortem study revealed increased serotonin 1A autoreceptor in the midbrain of suicide depressive, thus significantly decreasing serotonin activity in their brain that was associated with depressive suicides. Just like the oxygen paradox, when your serotonin is too high in your body, it could potentially cause serotonin syndrome. However, when the serotonin in your body is too low, it is associated, for example, with major depressive disorder. Symptoms might include such caps, abnormality, that is, sleep, interest, guilt, energy, concentration, appetite, psychomotor activity, and even suicidal ideation. Depression is a real illness, just like flu and diabetes. You cannot just tell them to suck it up, just to think positively, everything is just in your head. They might need more serotonin in their brains because they're lacking serotonin in their midbrain. Are you going to tell them not to take meds while they're actually suffering right now? They have those suicidal ideations. Depression is not less severe than physical illnesses. According to the World Health Organization, around 800,000 people die annually due to depressive suicide. In fact, suicide is the second leading cause of death and 15 to 29 year olds. I'm going to show you a few pieces of evidence to emphasize how serious and biological mental disorders are. One of the first few studies was done by the father of stress physiology, Hans Selye. He is an endocrinologist by training. In one of his researches, he deliberately caused stress in rats. And there were at least three things that he observed from the stress rats. He observed that most of the rats that were stressed out suffered from peptic ulcers, enlarged adrenal glands, and shrunken thymus gland. A more recent study showed the influence of depression on immunity. They found out that immunity and depression are strongly negatively correlated, meaning the more depressed someone, the lower their immunity is. The outcome variable they used in this study was the NK cells, or the natural killer cells. When depression is more severe, the natural killer cell activity decreases significantly. Another older study actually comes from a caregiver study. They found out that caregivers who actually experienced a lot of stress in their life showed a decline in at least three measures of cellular immunity relative to non-caregivers. And they were sick more days with respiratory tract infection. Another study has shown that people with high chronic stress are about twice more likely to catch colds from at least five different strains of cold viruses. With this logic, that means if you are more stressed, you are more likely to catch COVID-19 and die from it. So ask yourself, is it more beneficial for you to take meds for your stress, anxiety, depression, or any mental disorders, or not taking meds? From this video, I really hope that we don't stigmatize people with chronic mental disorders, stress, or even depression. I really hope that you don't punish yourself for being depressed or stressed chronically. If you feel like you're always stressed, that impairs your performance in your daily life or causes high distress in your life, seek professional help right away. Mental disorders do not differ from physical disorders. They need to be treated. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe if you like this video. And follow my Instagram right here. And happy Lunar New Year. 新年快乐，万事如意，千万不要忘记保持自由哦。See you in the next video.